DiscerningHearts.com presents Building a Kingdom of Love, Reflections with Monsignor John Esseff. Monsignor Esseff is a priest in the Diocese of Scranton, Pennsylvania. He has served as a retreat director and confessor to St. Mother Teresa of Calcutta. He continues to offer direction and retreats for the Sisters of the Missionaries of Charity. Monsignor Esseff encountered St. Padre Pio, who would become a spiritual father to him. He has lived in areas around the world, serving in the Pontifical Missions, a Catholic organization established by St. Pope John Paul II to bring the good news to the world, especially to the poor. He continues to serve as a retreat leader and director to bishops, priests, sisters, seminarians, and other religious leaders. Building a Kingdom of Love, Reflections with Monsignor John Esseff. I'm your host, Chris McGregor. What is on your heart today, Monsignor?
I believe so many people are carrying wounds and things that they really ought to bring to the sacrament of reconciliation, you know, about shame and pain. So today, the suggestion of thinking about our anger, what do we do with those feelings of anger? Did you ever meet someone that they actually have an angry disposition? They're almost ready to explode. A member of your family, someone at work, they're very touchy, and something, whatever might set them off. What is that in a person that they really need, and almost everybody needs to get in touch with their anger? All of us have it, and every one of us experience it. You experience it with your husband. A husband will experience with his wife. When you get angry with each other, what happens? When you have in daily living, you're coming in contact with each other, what do I do with my anger with a child? The kind of testing and testing sometimes, pushing and pushing that a child will do, to the point where I am and I have these feelings of angry for this child. What do I do with that? What do I do when I get angry with a friend? What happens at work when we get angry? My mother-in-law, my sister-in-law. So the members of my family, people around me, what is that that when I get angry that I do? Many times if a person, because of the familiarity and the situation, and it's kind of an everyday thing, that someone says something to you, and just like that, I say something back to them. When you say something to me that hurts me, or gets me angry, or even furious, or I want to retaliate, I become defensive, those feelings, and they stir right up in me. And you know, we've often been told, count to 10, but you can count to 100. And what she said has hurt me so much, or set me and ticked me off. What's the suggestion? What do I do? There's all kinds of anger that can get stirred. Did Jesus get angry? He certainly did. There's a scene in Matthew's gospel where Jesus enters into the temple and drove out all the money changers and those engaged in buying and selling. He overturned their tables and the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who were seating, who were selling doves. And he said to them, "It is written, my house is a house of prayer, but you have made it into a den of thieves." Jesus had tremendous anger there. He made a cord, he made a whip out of, and drove them out of the temple. Well, that's anger. And when, if you looked into his eyes, he was really angry, but he wasn't angry with the persons. He was angry with their action. Jesus always loved, even in the midst of the anger. Do you love and do you continue to love that person? And that's so important with regard to the person that you're angry with. You're angry with their behavior. It's so important when you experience anger, not just to count to 10, hold yourself in. The epistle of Paul, because he sees this also in Ephesians. We hear him how to handle our anger. Finally, draw your strength from the Lord and from his mighty power. Put on the armor of God so that you may be able to stand firm against the tactics of the devil. Be angry, but sin not, Paul says. Do not let the sun set on your anger. We can get angry, but ask and without sin, just as Jesus did. In prayer, if we turn immediately to God and ask the Father, ask Jesus, ask the Holy Spirit, take some time and ask Our Lady, tell the anger to God. Invite the Holy Spirit into the anger, what it is you're angry about. And if you pray before you respond, your response may be terrible, and you soon may be very sorry that you came back with that retaliatory word. And then listen to what God will tell you. In your anger, take time to pray, especially with those who are around you and you're familiar with, your wife. You're at the anger, and it can flare up, and it's those words that you say right then in anger that can be remembered for years. They cut deep into the one that you really love, but you say them in anger. As you hold back and pray, the patient person, the person who knows how to deal with his or her anger, has so much less to be sorry for the words you said. There's an old saying, make all your words sweet, because one day you're going to have to eat them. If you have those bitter words and those angry retorts that you have said in anger, and they come out, they're just really many times not true. Listen to what God has to say in your anger. Many times it'll be, well, she's having a bad day. She really didn't mean that. It wasn't the way you really took it. And so much peace can come from holding back your anger and not letting, as the scripture says, the sun set on your anger. And St. Paul says, do not give the devil a chance, because it's in those moments that the evil one, the enemy of our human nature, wants to tell you to come back with those words and those hurtful words that hurt and will hurt for many, many years if you say them in that retaliatory, angry way. The kinds of anger that go many times unresolved in our hearts. When you have anger, invite God into the anger. It could be a long-standing unforgiveness with your father, with your wife, with an ex-spouse that goes unresolved. Anger has a way of just setting and seething in a person. The unresolved angers just cause us to live in a high state of tension. And it really many times, I believe, shortens our lives, because we live with this tension, unresolved anger. And God so wants to heal us. What accounts for, and you're in traffic, and you don't even know the person that may just cut in front of you or whatever. Road rage. This person who, and I actually saw one time, I was in Beirut, and there was somebody who cut off. And this man was so infuriated with something that another driver was doing that he went after him and was waving a gun at the other person, not even knowing who it was. Anger can be the source of so much damage in our lives. Today, as we contemplate and think about this feeling that we have, I would very much ask you to think about and encourage you to think about people, especially in your lives. There may be a member of your family that is irritating and causes you to be angry. What is that that you want to invite? What is that behavior in that person that can get to you and cause you this anger? It's not hurting that other person. It's damaging you. You are being completely controlled in your life by someone else's action and someone else's way of living. Invite God into your anger. Ask God to help you resolve the many conflicts or difficulties, the fury, the disposition of aggressiveness that you have within your life. God desires you to live in peace. And this disposition can be very helpful at times. It was with Jesus in cleansing the temple. It can be to have you carry out something that God wants you to do. Of itself, anger is not a sin of itself. But many times it can lead to hurt and unhappiness and even violence in a person's life. And I really believe, again, that our society, you know, there may be a politician that causes you anger. What is it in you? And how does this, on a daily basis, cause your life to be unhappy? There may be a different pastor that you have, or you as a pastor. Do you get angry with the altar servers? Do you get angry with parishioners? Is your anger something that God is using to help you be a good shepherd of souls? Recently, you know, I think I heard it from you, Chris, that our Holy Father said, it's very important for us in the church to recognize our enemies. And our chief enemy is Satan. And Satan can very easily play on this. St. Paul says, do not let the sun set on your anger. Do not give the devil a chance to work with these feelings of yours, to nag at you, to tempt you, to drive you into actions that are not of God. Anger is many times, it does not work the plans of God.
Monsignor, with anger, sometimes it flashes up so quickly.
Yes.
It's just something that it's almost like a lightning bolt. Mm-hmm. And we speak or we act before we even think. Literally, the words come out of our mouths or the things are said. What do we do with that? Because it has such a ripple effect, doesn't it?
Oh, can first of all, go over those things that you, without thinking and without restraint, said and in anger, and how they just come out and cause tremendous pain all around you. My dad, in growing up, my dad had a very bad temper. And as a child, I just remember he worked with people who cursed a lot. And he worked in very difficult places. You know, the marketplace was a place where you could hear every kind of curse and foul language. And when he would open up his mouth in anger, that terror goes right through the children. And when you're around people who are constantly spouting off, you put a clamp on your feelings. And some of us have feelings of anger that we never express and can become passive aggressive. You hold it back and you let it out in different ways. That your anger is let out by a passive aggressive way, but still it's an anger that you're waiting in a way like shooting your arrows in the dark, but you're still angry. The passive aggressive can come out of anger. And that's another way of expressing anger. But those who have uncontrolled anger, just think about yourself or others saying things that are so hurtful and long-lasting. Yes. And so that's why it's important, I think, to pray about and to think about, how do I act when I feel this rage, this fury? Think about your feelings, yes. And they come on us all of a sudden. That's what can happen. But if I'm used to just having this freedom or license to blast off with what I feel, then I really believe in your life as a Christian, as a Catholic, as a Protestant, just a follower of Jesus. Be very careful of your tongue. The tongue can bless, but the same tongue, as St. James says, can curse.
It's something that can always flare up in us too, can it? I mean, there are those who may feel, well, I've dealt with my quote-unquote anger issues. I'm not angry. I may even say I've been healed of my anger issues. And yet it's something that can always potentially trip us up.
I'm a visitor of like nursing homes. Mm-hmm. And so where would you think that there'd be most calm and no anger? Not true. It can flare up there. If you're a nurse and you're working in a nursing home, or if you're an aide, somebody who has called for you and you have delayed coming, and what you can hear from that patient who is impatient. And so that age doesn't take away the potential. If you were an angry young man, and you haven't dealt with it, you're going to be an angry old man. I was in, I'm in a place where there's elderly priests. Mm-hmm. Some of them are terribly, terribly angry. They were angry young men, and now they're angry old men. If they were angry young women, and they're angry old women. I don't think age is something that lets us free of anger. But if you pray, and there's so sweetness, you can just see those who have controlled their anger, who have prayed through their anger, the gentleness, the sweetness, the evenness of their lives. How we want to be around people, and you could be that person. If you're a person who has an angry disposition, and you're listening to this, how important it is that you take that in, because the person who is being most damaged is you. You can actually live in that state of life of tranquility and serenity and peace. And the fire of your anger can be used in a controlled way on a daily basis, so that fury and that those angry outbursts, which cause you to be very depressed, because that angry people, after they have had their explosion, carry within themselves terrible guilt if they haven't dealt with their anger.
It seems like it's a wonderful weapon for evil.
Yes.
Because it truly is double-pointed. Because it gets the person and it gets somebody else, potentially.
Yes. The words of St. Paul, therefore, putting away falsehood, speak the truth each to one another and to his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun set on your anger, and do not leave room for the devil. That's what it does. If you just let yourself in a state of anger, his activity intensifies right in the angry disposition and the atmosphere that continues on between you and your wife, between you and your children, between brothers and sisters, in a family, at your work, at your school. Wherever this disposition is allowed to continue and seethe, the devil's at work. Such activity, stirring up the thoughts. That's why it's so important at those times to invite God into the situation. God, come into this angry situation where there's such clash in unions, where there's such clash in politics, where there's such clash in the ordinary activities of humans. There is going to be time for anger, and there certainly needs to be time for God.
Final thoughts, Monsignor?
That anger is a human feeling, and it all of us have anger. And anger of itself is not sinful, but it can, if we do not invite God into the use of it, can cause tremendous. It can lead to murder. It can lead to war. It can lead to all kind of violence. If it's unrestrained, it can burn down our civilization. And yet, that same disposition can give us power and strength and courage to face our enemies. And so, I really believe that in our ordinary lives, that God wants us to look at this. And especially, I'm bringing this up before myself and for all of us to ask God in our lives to forgive us our misuse of anger and the times we have not been loving and caring toward our neighbor, toward our wives, toward others, and even for those of you who got angry with God. Many times in our lives, we can become angry with God. Jesus got angry with God on the cross when he cried out, "Elohi, Elohi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you abandoned me?" Jesus had anger. That's actually Psalm 22. And if you read that psalm, he's crying out and he's saying these dispositions of his heart. He's been rejected by his friends, abandoned by everyone who followed him. His disciples have left him. The people that he even cured and healed and blessed have called for his crucifixion, or at least silently let him go to the cross. And as he looked and surveyed what was there beneath the cross, he even felt that his Father had abandoned him. And he cries out in anger to God. Have you had a child that was killed? And they said, it's God's will. And you're angry with God. Have you lost your job and you were really trying to be a good Christian at that job and you did everything right? And in your soul, you're saying, why have you abandoned me, God? You could be angry with God. And Jesus was. But it always did the will of his Father. And so you can be angry with God as Jesus was. But never go away from him. After he said, my God, why have you abandoned me? Then he said, it is finished. You have given me what you have given me to do, to die. And so with each of us, anger can be a very deep part of all our lives. And so ask God to assist you and help you in your activities and your daily life, especially those moments when you flare up in fury and anger. Invite God into it. He's always there.
Thank you so much, Monsignor.
You're so welcome. God bless you.
You've been listening to Building a Kingdom of Love, Reflections with Monsignor John Esseff. To hear and or to download this episode, along with hundreds of other spiritual formation programs, visit discerninghearts.com. This has been a production of Discerning Hearts. I'm your host, Chris McGregor. We hope that if this has been helpful for you, that you will first pray for our mission. And if you feel us worthy, consider a charitable donation, which is fully tax deductible, to help support our efforts. But most of all, we hope that you will tell a friend about discerninghearts.com and join us next time for Building a Kingdom of Love, Reflections with Monsignor John Esseff.